Bow our heads and we'll begin. Father, we're into the last session, and it's just been such a blessing to have our thinking challenged and to look at things possibly in a different way and to try and touch the heart of God and see that your ways or your thoughts are really not our thoughts. And we've been caught in a false system, a false understanding. And as we engage in this last presentation, please, Lord, help us to understand the surface things and the deep things. There is both involved in this presentation. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. By now, you'll be fairly familiar with these charts, so I'm not going to spend time with these. The shift, how humanity shifted. And the comparison between the two kingdoms, God's kingdom and Satan's kingdom, and the elements that are in both. Now, we want to look at the fact of God's kingdom being invisible and its impact on our thinking, on our doctrines, our theology. And this is an interesting verse. Luke chapter 17, verses 20 and 21. Now, when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, "The kingdom of God does not come with outward observation." That text, that statement has, what's the word, severe application for us today. The kingdom of God does not come with observation or outward observation, when the Greek would say. Nor will we say, "See here" or "See there," for indeed the kingdom of God is where? Within you. Does not come with outward observation, with the eyes, or the physical eyes. It comes with spiritual eyes. It's because it's within you. And this is a concept that we want to develop. I've been talking a lot about relational. What is some of the ways that we help to facilitate a relational kingdom focus with God? Well, the first thing here is that it's invisible. Many people say to me, "How do I conduct a relationship with an invisible God?" It's a fairly basic question, but it's a good question. How do I relate to someone that's invisible that I can't see? And sometimes I feel that I can't talk to. This is an important question. Let's bring it down to the human level. Here is a couple. We assume it's a couple. Do you know who they are? Oh, neither do I. I just got it off Google, off the internet. Thought you'd like that. I don't know who they are. I think they're a couple. Now, what can you tell me about their relationship? They seem happy enough. She might be standing on his toe and he's smiling, saying, "Get off." But, you know, we don't know, do we? We don't know. They look happy. They look, they might be two actors that have just posed for the camera. We don't know. We can't tell. Not from this picture, but I would assume they're a couple. How stable is their relationship? Do you know? You can't tell, can you? What else? Stable, healthy? Do they trust one another? How much do they trust each other? Are they content in their relationship with each other? Can you tell from that picture? You can't. The point I'm trying to make here is that relationships are not seen. You can't see them. Husband and wives, you can see the effects of a relationship, but you cannot see the relationship. The relationship operates in the spiritual realm. It is one mind connected with another mind with a set of protocols, and I hate to make it sound so ugh, but where two minds agree together on a number of issues, and they have experiences and they have memories together. That's what a relationship is. But all those things are not seen. They're all unseen. And this is an extension of the principle of our relationship with God. The relationship is unseen to the human eye. We see the results of the relationship, but we can't see the relationship. All right, 2 Corinthians 4:18. "While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal." Has it ever occurred to you that everything that you can see right now and everything that you have ever seen in your life will one day be gone? Have you thought about that? Nothing that you see, nothing that you own in a material way will be here soon. It'll all be gone. There'll only be one thing left. And that's the part of you that's invisible. Not even your flesh and bone will be here. It will have a new, but we will have new bodies, immortal bodies. There's only one thing that will go through, and that's the part of you that you cannot see. The invisible, the character, the personality. That's what goes through. And so we are told here to focus on what? The unseen. The unseen. Let's explore this a little bit with Moses. It says, and he, Moses, said, please show me your glory. It's interesting. I remember as a young Christian kneeling down and saying, dear Lord, you know what? I'd really like to see an angel. It'd be really nice, you know? Because then I get brag rights. I've seen an angel. I'm sure that was part of my motivation. I'd like to see an angel. But Moses here, probably for a different reason to my prayer, said, please show me your glory. Then he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I'll proclaim the name of the Lord before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no man shall see my face and live. Notice, even as Moses says, show me your glory, how does God respond? What does he talk about? Graciousness, compassion? He talks about characteristics, things that are not seen. And then he says, you cannot see my face and live. There's really significant issues here in this text. And the Lord said, here is a place by me, and you shall stand on the rock. So it shall be while my glory passes by that I will put you in the cleft of the rock and will cover you with my hand while I pass by. Then I will take away my hand and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. God is patient, isn't he? Did he need to do that for Moses? He went to great lengths. But why was it that God says, you will not see my face? Could you imagine if Moses had quickly sketched down the face of God? What would have happened? Having the face of God everywhere, on pictures everywhere? What would happen? Idol worship. God says, you will not do that to me. I will not allow you to corrupt yourself like that. You will not see my face. Because you are idolatrous in your outlook on life. We will see God face to face one day when idolatry is removed from us, when we no longer are like that. And of course, we're in that process right now to remove idolatry. Notice another verse, Deuteronomy 4:12, another verse along these lines. And the Lord spoke to you, this is Moses reciting, the Lord spoke to you out of the midst of fire. You heard the sound of the words, but you saw no form. You only heard a voice. God's way of interacting with the human race, the voice. What does it say in Isaiah? It says, you will hear a word behind you saying, when you turn to the left and to the right, a voice to speak to us. Why the voice? The voice represents the character, the person. That's the significant factor. And of course, Exodus 20 verse 4, you shall not make for yourself any carved image. I love you too much to allow you to make an image of me and fall in love with that image rather than me. I will not allow you to do that to yourself. And if you do that, you will lose your connection with me. And please don't do it. Please don't do it. We start to begin to understand when there's a focus on the invisible, why Jesus said he had to go away. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. How could the Comforter come if everybody on the earth knew that Jesus was living somewhere on the earth? Would they even sense there was a Holy Spirit? They wouldn't even be thinking about the Holy Spirit. They would just be thinking about where Jesus is. But when Jesus moves away, the visible becomes invisible, the Holy Spirit is able to come in and minister, bring Christ to us in an invisible way. What if Christ have had his photo taken while he was here on earth? What would happen? Terrible. We have enough trouble with this thing called the Shroud of Turin. People worshipping and, oh, we have the face of Jesus now. We've got to go and touch it now. Even the serpent that Moses, the bronze serpent that Moses put on the pole, remember that? They looked to the serpent and they were healed. You know what the people of Israel did after that? They started worshipping the serpent on the pole rather than the God that healed them. Let us understand from these lessons that not only the Israelites, but us, we are so idolatrous in nature. And it goes back to Adam and Eve when the serpent or Satan said to Eve, if you eat, you will experience the divine through the material. You eat the fruit, you experience the exhilaration, and that is how you find the divine. Does that make sense? There's a big point there. That's Satan's big push. Experience the thrill. Blow your nervous system apart. That's what it is to experience the divine. Blow your brains out with all kinds of substances and stuff. That's experiencing the divine. Experience sexuality to the max. That's experiencing the divine. That's what the Gnostics would tell us. That's what Da Vinci Code would tell us. That's the essence of the divine, to experience sexuality. It says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the helper will not come to you. And if he did not go away, we would have been stuck with idolatry. We would have wanted to worship him. Even Mary struggled with this issue. Jesus knew this. You know, when she comes to the tomb, the King James doesn't render it as well, but Jesus says, Mary, you have to let go of me now. I have to go back to my Father. There was that temptation of clinging to the person. How nice it would have been to feel the touch and to feel the embrace of Jesus. Wouldn't that be so wonderful? But that's not what God's kingdom is primarily about. It's about the relationship. It's the hug and the embrace in the spiritual realm, not the physical realm. There's still embrace, there's still hug. And God still does it through each of us. He still gives us the hugs through each other. But we are too idolatrous to risk. He can't risk it with us yet. Not yet, but in heaven. John chapter 4, verse 20, speaking of this issue, Jesus, this is the woman at the well, Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. But the hour is coming, and now is when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." That statement clearly tells us that in terms of geography, that there are no holy places on the face of this planet. Did you hear what I said? There are no holy places. You will not worship in this mountain, nor yet in Jerusalem, but those who worship the Father will worship him in spirit and in truth. Your focus will not be on geography, it will not be on material, physical substance, but it will be on heaven and your spiritual connection or relationship with God. That's the focus. So all this fighting and killing over holy places and all this stuff, it's all a decoy. It's all a decoy. To claim that you have a church or a mosque, and understand me when I say this, to say that you have a church or a mosque or whatever place of worship you have, and to say that that place is holy in and of itself, is a decoy. It's a decoy. The building doesn't make the place holy. It's God's presence that makes the place holy. This church is holy because of God, not because of the building. Now we understanding that this is God's house, we don't treat it with disrespect. Let's always get the balance here. We don't, as I often say to my son, please don't run in the church. I wish I said it like that. Don't run! We want to have respect for God, and we want to be in an atmosphere where we can feel his presence, but it's not It's not the vinyl and the carpet that and the chandeliers that make this place holy. It's God's presence that makes this place holy. Okay. Just stay with me on this. This is to do with the new covenant. Jesus had to go away for the law to be written on the heart. This is what the new covenant is all about. The visible and the invisible is so important to understand in terms of the new covenant. For if the first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. Hebrews 8:8 says, because finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the days I took them by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I disregarded them, says the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their mind, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Notice the shift in the covenant between the old covenant and the new covenant. The old covenant was a visible. God spoke to them through the visible. He had to give them these symbols, but they had to see through the visible into the invisible. The problem was, as it says, finding fault with them, they could not see past the visible. And all they saw was the temple of the Lord. So great became their desire to protect this temple, they would rather crucify the creator of that system than give it up. That's serious idolatry, isn't it? Serious. This man that can destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. So Jesus, to write the new covenant on our hearts, he had to leave because we are so idolatrous. We are so focused on the physical. We are so enamored with touch and feel and sight that he had to go away and send his spirit. And that is the only way he could write his law on our heart. The real Jesus. Not the Jesus where you feel the flesh and the bone or his power. You know, I have New Age friends who, they said, oh man, I had an awesome Bible study this morning. I said, yeah, I just picked up a new version and I just put it to my chest and man, it felt great. That's idolatry. How about actually reading it? Hearing the voice? Can you see the difference? You know, you just feel the aura around the book and you put it to your chest and you have an awesome Bible study. I tried hard not to laugh, believe me. It's going, whoa, that's heavy. Oh, Lord, give me wisdom. How do you answer that? So this is the essence of the new covenant, that Jesus needed to go away. And I experienced this firsthand because when my wife and I were engaged, there was a time when we were apart and we had to write letters to each other. And we had to see whether we could survive just on writing letters. And we actually began to write and talk about the things that were important without the touch, without the feel. And we found that we still had a connection. We still had a love for one another. We still had interests that were the same, even though we couldn't see each other. And that taught me an important lesson. You know, and I was like this, young people, you want a relationship? You got to touch, you got to feel, you got to experiment, you got to try everything. Oh, talk. Yeah, that's right, you got to talk too. Just want the experience. Yeah. But mind to mind relationships. Let's have a look at the next point. God's kingdom. In God's kingdom, relationships are about clear identity, effective communication. We've talked about all these things. Focus on character and appreciate personality. The unseen. Personality, character are not things that you can hang up on the wall. They're unseen to the physical eye. In Satan's kingdom, it's all about body shape and size, intelligence, wealth, talent, fame. These are all the things that are important. You need to connect yourself to someone because visibly they are all of these things. They look beautiful. They look strong. They have money. They drive a nice car. They have, you know, they have something that you want, and you can connect yourself to them, then you feel powerful as well. That's what relationships are about in Satan's kingdom. This next slide is interesting. And we're coming down to human relationships now, and we're seeing a disturbing pattern continuing to re-emerge for us in terms of how we negotiate relationships. This is... do you know those girls? No, that's Google again. And I write down here, what women want most, they are taught to advertise least. And I won't read out that list, but when you're advertising like this, what are you advertising? Personality? Character? Invisible? What are you advertising? You're advertising flesh. And there's one thing the Bible says, without trying to get too grotesque, there's one thing the Bible says about flesh, is that's where the eagles and the vultures love to gather. Flesh. Because it's dead. Dead flesh. That's where vultures gather. And if you dress like that, you're only going to attract vultures. You got the joke, yeah, okay. You don't want to attract vultures, do you? You want to attract someone with high moral principle. And we are losing within our culture, within our church, the ability to teach young people how to advertise correctly. How to establish a relationship that's on a platform that will last. And so we push the physical and we push all of these things. And then you get into a relationship and it all feels good until the next morning. And it's all gone. All the warm, fuzzy feeling is gone. And you've got a headache and you've got a hangover and it's all too late. And that's how many relationships are started. Just like that. And we need to reverse these trends. But if you want to feel special, and this is where it comes down to, if you want to feel special, and particularly for a young lady, if she doesn't have a father figure to tell her that she's special, to tell her that she's pretty, to tell her that she's really, really important, then somebody else will tell her, but for a very, very different reason. For a very, very different reason. And for some young ladies, they find out too late that men are very, very different and have very, very different motives and objectives in mind. They're not like their dad. Well, if they've got a decent father. That's why the role of a father, particularly for a teenage young lady, is so important. To be able to experience intimacy and closeness with someone that will not take advantage of you and love you just for who you are. So important. And yet we're losing that today. We just, everyone, everywhere, it just comes in through the movies, it comes through everywhere. Jolly Britney Spears, I don't know. Everyone's wearing this midriff stuff. You know, they got no idea, these young teenage girls, they got no idea what they are doing. No idea. And who's going to tell them? You're advertising for vultures, and that's what you're going to get. Someone that's going to devour you and destroy you and rip you to shreds. That's all that does. But when you need value and you know that you can turn heads because of the way you dress like this, it's almost too overpowering not to do it because it makes you feel special. And that's something that we have to deal with. I think this is another area where it says, well, I'll turn there right now, Titus. Let's turn to Titus. This is a passage that I've been pondering. Titus chapter 2, verse 3. It says, the older women likewise, that they be reverent in behaviour, not slanderers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That they admonish the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet. What does that mean? Chaste. Discreet, chaste, homemakers, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. That the word of God be not blasphemed. This is not an option, people. This is what the word of God says. And I can hear all the bells going off. Jolly, what? Obedience, submit, not submitting to him. That's what we've failed on, teaching. Teaching in the right way, not in Satan's kingdom, submitting to dominance and control and woman being a slave. That's not God's ideal. But in God's kingdom, this is critical, the role of husband and wife. And if I can say just briefly on this point, digressing slightly, it says in the book of Timothy in regard to roles, it says in 1 Timothy chapter 3, it says about a husband, about a number of things, and it says, one who rules his own household well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if he does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? There is an intimate link between family and church. And this is why it is my personal conviction that our church is making a big mistake by moving down a path to ordain women to pastoral leadership. Because it says here that they must rule their house. But if they must rule their house, then the blessing that the patriarch gives is lost. I can understand in Satan's kingdom why we would need to create equality in those roles, because that's the way it is. But in God's kingdom, role does not mean value. Role does not mean value. And I would say to most ladies that would desire that position, are you crazy? Do you know how hard it is? The stuff you have to deal with? Why put that on yourself? We're starting to break up the order of heaven. We are starting to say that value does come by position rather than through relationship. And I know that sometimes that men make it very difficult for women by their laziness and their arrogance and just sitting back and saying we're not doing anything and something needs to be done. Men, we shouldn't put ladies in that position. When something needs to be done, we need to stand up and do it. And it's no wonder the ladies get frustrated. Well, it's not getting done. And they feel like, well, we've got to do something. That's putting them in a temptation that's very difficult. We should deal with it. That the word of God be not blasphemed, as it says here. Anyway, that's another whole subject. I can see the cogs are turning and going, interesting. So to my friends within the church and those that believe that we need to create ordination for women as pastors that are watching the DVD, I say we're making a big mistake. We're creating equality on a false basis, and that's on the basis of performance. And you don't want to do that. If you feel you've arrived because you get ordination in this role, you're making a big mistake. A big mistake. All right, what does it say? Do not let your adornment be merely outward, or as the King James say, to be outward. Don't let your focus be on outward adornment, arranging of the hair, wearing of gold, putting on a fine apparel. You know, how do we teach this teaching to young people? You know, no jewelry, no makeup, dress properly, come here, how long is your skirt? I've seen that done. That really gets the benefits across. Sometimes we're pretty lousy salesmen, aren't we? How to sell a doctrine, how to sell a teaching. You know, sometimes it's hard and the peer pressure is there. We pull our hair out trying to explain this. But if we want a lasting relationship, both on earth and in heaven, we need to focus on the invisible rather than the visible. That's what we need to focus on. Don't advertise the physical. That alone should be kept for husband or wife. That's something sacred. It says the marriage bed is holy and undefiled. It's not for anybody else to look at. The degradation, you know, the stuff that I see people wear today, it makes me weep. How can you do that to yourself in an effort to gain attention? It says, but rather let it be the hidden person of the heart with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit which is precious in the sight of God. This is the focus. And trust God. And I guess to say to those that, you know, feel that they're being left behind, what's that term? Left on the shelf. Trust God. Don't sell yourself short. Don't enter into relationships based on advertising something that really you're not really looking for. And that's what, and I didn't say this before, I guess from a lady's point of view, it says in Genesis 3:16 that a woman's desire is towards her husband. She wants more than anything else to be close to someone, to be able to share what's in her heart and to have her husband share what's in his heart. That's the most important thing, at least as my wife tells me. And I try and do the right thing. But from a man's perspective, he has to learn those things. It doesn't come natural for him. He's more interested in other things, the physical. And if you advertise the physical and then you say you want the spiritual, then you're advertising falsely. That's false advertising. Isn't it? But I wouldn't call it false, because if you don't know, then it's not really false, it's just ignorance. And we can say that God, at times of ignorance, he does wink at. But now, for everyone here, we command all to repent. All right, you'll like this next picture. Men just simply don't know what they want. See, God puts within women a desire for relationship, the ability to express their feelings and their thoughts. Men have to learn this. It's a learned skill. He's a cool dude, isn't he? It's just the typical male, all the testosterone, look at me, I'm so cool. Men don't know what they want. They have to be taught, and they should be taught by their father and their mother what to look for. But unfortunately, that doesn't happen. We just say, oh, men are just men, you know, they're just boys will be boys. And they're just, because men are visually driven, if that is not checked, if they are not taught to discipline themselves and to see that if you want to lay a strong foundation for a long-lasting relationship, you need to allow God to cultivate your passions and your tendencies. You don't do that, you are going to end up with Delilah. And that's not good. You're going to lose your strength. You're dead. And so this poor fellow thinks he's got it all. He's headed for destruction. Visually driven, being a hero, strength, intelligence, aggression, assets. You know, that's why men love to watch all these Braveheart-type movies. And this is another thing, just by the way. If you watch movies on a regular basis, you know you're being evangelized for a false relationship system. You are taught that a relationship is only achieved once a man proves and does something great to win the affection of a young woman, which means that a relationship is only contracted in a performance context. Hollywood's not dumb. They understand that. So you keep watching that stuff, you're going to keep believing that stuff, and you'll never ever be happy. I mean, Hollywood proves that to us, don't they? Look at their relationships. Talk about a group of mixed up, worthless individuals. They don't know which way's up. We should pray for them. All right. And we need to pray for the men, that they will know what they want in God's context, that they'll be taught to look for the things that are unseen rather than things that are seen. Learn to appreciate in others the unseen rather than desiring to see the visible and the tangible all the time. All right, let's bring it now to the issue of worship. Now it gets interesting. How are we going for time? 6:30. Worship. If God's kingdom is invisible, if it has an invisible focus, how does an invisible focus affect the way we worship? Will it affect the way we worship? How we worship God? It must. Do we focus on the visible or the invisible in our worship? In God's kingdom, the focus is going to, must be, has to be the Word of God. That's the focus. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Romans 10:17, 1 Peter 2:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God. Worship must be based around the Word. I heard a word behind me saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. And Jesus in Revelation 19, when he comes again, he has a banner and it says on him what? The Word of God. Jesus is who? The Word of God. Our worship is based around the Word. If we're having an invisible focus. Oh, I'm starting to get wound up now. The Word of God. All right. Meditation on God. Do you ever sit down and actually think about God? How wonderful He is. The good things that He does for you. Or you're just saying, gimme, gimme, gimme. I need this, fix this, change this. How do you pray? How do you talk to God? Have you ever sat down and just thought about, you know, sometimes I think, boy, Lord, what were you thinking when you made a lorikeet? That's wild. You're awesome. Do you ever think like that? Meditation on God. Emphasis on stillness. Be still and know that I am God. Mind to mind occurs in the stillness, in the quietness, as we talk softly to each other, quietly. What did it say when Elijah ran off and God came to him and there's an earthquake and there's fire and the mountain shakes and God wasn't in any of those things? Where was God? Still small voice. He speaks to us with a still small voice. He comes close to us. We all understand, you understand, don't you, that when you want to be intimate, something intimate, a symbol of intimacy is someone whispering in your ear. Isn't that something intimate? And so our focus is on intimacy. It's going to be stillness, quietness. Listen. Listen to the Word of God as He speaks to your soul. Character focus. Emphasis on character. Love, joy, peace, all of these things. And I've written there, emphasize melody. Now we're talking about music. In the domain of music, the melody line is what carries the spiritual. The harmony is what carries the mental. And the rhythm carries the physical. That's interesting, isn't it? Well, you can feel, when you feel the bass, you can feel your whole body is just, it's a massage, isn't it? It feels great. But is that the centre of our worship? I had a man I was speaking to, he asked me what religion I was. I said, oh, Seventh-day Adventist. He said, my religion is rhythm. At the time, I thought he was an idiot. But then I thought later on, yeah, I see what he's saying now. Rhythm. The worship of rhythm. The massage of the body. It does everything. It makes you feel really good. You can just let yourself go with it. Feels great. Feels like God, doesn't it? But there's nothing going on up here. It's just a feeling. Emphasize melody. As we're singing those songs before, the emphasis is on the melody. The word, because it's the word. The word is carried on the melody, and the melody is what we speak to God, and we want to communicate with Him. So the emphasis will be on melody. And harmony. In Satan's kingdom, the emphasis is on intensity of feeling. Now, it doesn't mean in God's kingdom you don't feel. You will feel. But the focus is not on feeling in God's kingdom. But in Satan's kingdom, you must feel, because it's in the realm of space, in the realm of three dimensions, that you feel something. If you don't feel it, it's not real. And the focus becomes on intensity of feeling. I need to feel something. That's why so many people are happy to go to meetings and they will themselves to be slayed in the spirit, to be knocked over and to feel something. Oh, I'm feeling something. God must be God. Well, that's not a connection. That's just feeling. You know, I thought you could probably get the same feeling in the microwave. The miraculous. I need to see with my eyes people falling over and things happening and a word of prophecy and something happen and I can stomp up and down like this and like this. And oh, it's great, isn't it? Reminds me of the prophets of Baal, jumping up and down. That's what we're going to talk about here. The miraculous. We don't know if God's there unless we can see something happen. What kind of faith is that? That's not faith. That's legalism. I have to see something and then I know that God is with me. You must perform something. You must do something. God, do something miraculous, otherwise I'm insecure. I don't know that you're here. Speak in tongues. Do something. You have to do something. That's the worst gospel I've ever heard. Legalistic to the max. Got to do something, got to perform. Activity and action. There's activity and action in God's kingdom. Don't worry about that. But the focus, always got to be something happen. Because if you be still, then you have to deal with your thoughts, and you might not like your thoughts. No rest for the wicked. That's an interesting thought. Activity and action. You know, just boring. Just listening to the Word of God. Just, you know, opening the Bible. So boring. Now, I remember when I was 18 years of age, and I was sitting at home and had the radio blaring, the whole room's, everything's shaking and moving, and I'd just given my heart to the Lord, and God said to me, you know, I'd like you to read the Bible. Okay. I just felt this impression. Yeah, I really should read the Bible. So I sit down and I turn off the music and it goes quiet, and, you know, and I'm just sitting there, and in you, O Lord, I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Oh, it's boring. Turn on the music. Oh, it's better. God said to me, you're not going to get far like that. If you need the music all the time, you're being medicated. You need to discipline yourself to be still. If you can't live without the music, you've got a problem. That's what God taught me. That's my testimony, my experience. Believe me, I love music. Love lots of music. Still like it loud too. But certain types of music. That's not going to take away the emphasis on the melody. Power focus. You know, invoking the power of God and the power to heal and the power to do this. And it's all about power. That's what happens in Satan's kingdom. And emphasize rhythm and bass. Rhythm and bass, because it touches you in the physical. You can feel it. You can feel the floor shaking. You can feel it all happening. Oh, God is here. What God? The God of flesh? It's a dead God. And you know, if we think that simply by getting together and we can say the name of Jesus and we can sway around and the beat's going and we feel great, if you think that you've had a connection with God just on that basis, I refer to that as froth and bubble. It's not very sustaining. You can't live on that. Doesn't work. Tried it. Doesn't work. So take it from an old pastor. It doesn't work. 1 Kings 18:36. Let's have a look at the issue of the contrast between Elijah and the prophets of Baal. It says in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 150, then bowing reverently before the unseen God. Interesting. Bowing reverently before the unseen God. He raises his hand towards heaven and offers a simple prayer. As Elijah prays, no senseless shrieks resound over Carmel's height. He prays as if he knows Jehovah is there. Now that's faith. He doesn't have to say, oh God, please, I hope you're there, help me. He knows God's there. He doesn't have to do any crazy stuff. He just prays to him by faith. That's powerful worship. And when he finished praying, man, you should have seen power and action. Fire and boom and stuff happening. But of course, before that, we see the prophets of Baal as they continued their frenzied devotions, whipping themselves up, trying to make themselves feel wonderful. All day long, the people have witnessed the demonstrations of the baffled priests. They have beheld their wild leaping around the altar. Sounds like a mosh pit to me. Let's just surf the crowd, peoples. That's a performance-based. You've got to feel it. If you don't feel it, then it's not happening for you. And here I just worship. God's focus in the invisible focus. The focus is on preaching of the word, conviction, and repentance. Notice Great Controversy, page 461. Wherever the word of God has been faithfully preached, results have followed that attested to divine origin. Sinners felt their consciences quickened, deep conviction took hold upon their minds and hearts. They were convinced of sin and righteousness and of judgment to come. If you come into church just to have fun, you're in the wrong place. You're in the wrong place. You come to church to be challenged, to be convicted, to be confronted, and to deal with sin in your life in an atmosphere of security, that God loves you and he cares for you, but he loves you too much to allow you to go on sinning. He wants you to change, to save your life. Conviction and repentance. When the Holy Spirit comes to you, and some people seem to overlook this, in John 16 verse 8 it says, when he, the Spirit, comes, he will convict you, what of first? Sin. Is that a nice feeling, or a nice warm fuzzy feeling, being convicted of sin? No. Then of righteousness. Now we have a need for righteousness because we've been convicted of sin, and of judgment to come. That's how we worship in God's kingdom. But in Satan's kingdom, it's a visible focus. We focus on drama. We focus on upbeat music. We focus on entertainment. Let's have fun. As long as we laugh and we can entertain and we can do all these things. Now we're really stepping on toes. Reassurance. Just keep reassuring. You hear messages coming from this side. You're okay. It's okay. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And you have to keep that mantra up, because deep down inside, the Spirit is saying, you've got a problem. You need to change. Worship. What God do you worship? A visible God or an invisible God? This is the question. Popular revivals are too often carried to appeals to the imagination, by exciting the emotions, by gratifying the love for what is new and startling. Converts thus gained have little desire to listen to Bible truth, little interest in the testimony of prophets and apostles. Unless a religious service has something of a sensational character, it has no attraction for them. A message which appeals to unimpassioned reason awakens no response. The plain warnings of God's word relating directly to their eternal interests are unheeded. And I can say, brothers and sisters, that we have a massive problem in this area in our church. Big problem. We are losing our sense of who we are as a people over this. We're exchanging, and let me make this very clear. When God's people came to Mount Sinai, and Moses was up in the mountain, the people couldn't handle the invisible. Moses, their leader, was gone. And so they made themselves a golden calf that they could see with their eyes. And they didn't call it Baal worship. You know what they called it? The worship of Jehovah. The worship of God. They come to God with their Baal worship, and they call it the worship of Jehovah. Are we in danger of doing the same thing today? I think we could be. It says in the last days that these things will happen, as it happened in those days, and like in the time of Moab, when the Moabite women came in and they had a feast and they had all these things happening. We've said that those things will be reenacted in the last days. Music and dancing and all this kind of stuff in God's church. It wasn't the worship of God, it was the worship of Moloch, Baal and Asherah. And it was dressed up as the worship of Jehovah. Gets a good crowd, and if it gets a good crowd, it must be right. Right? The point is, how we conduct our relationship and how we worship God will reflect which kingdom we favour or belong to. That's a challenging statement, isn't it? How we conduct our relationships and how we worship God will reflect the kingdom we favour or belong to. Do you desire physical, tangible, visible, or do you desire the invisible? Is that what you are looking for? And I think probably at that point, we better stop. I've got another whole hour here of implications, but I've had it. And I think we're probably a bit full up. So I just want to leave those thoughts with you. Think about the visible versus the invisible. And the reason I bring that up is because of relationship. And we've been talking about relationship-based kingdom. A relationship-based kingdom will have relationship-based worship, not performance-based worship. That's important. And our relationships that we have with each other will be relationally focused, not performance-focused. And I think if we can take on board some of these things, we need to pray about them and look at them, then I think that we'll be saved from many heartaches and many challenges. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we looked at some challenging material tonight. But Lord, we're just so thankful that you love us enough to challenge us, to make us think. Lord, I just pray for each of us here that we will not conduct our relationships on the physical level alone, but first through the spiritual, and let that live out through the physical, rather than through the physical, and let that squash and demolish the spiritual. And Father, we just pray that in our worship, that we will think carefully about which God we worship. The names are unimportant. The style will determine which God we worship. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name.